Hi friends, Joseph Kursky here with you to guide you through the process of accessing, downloading, and using data from the national map. We're going to focus on ArcGIS Pro. Go to the nationalmap.gov, go to the bottom of the page, and get elevation data. It's strange that it's at the bottom of the page, but there it is. Then I'm going to select a study area. I'm going to select Grand Junction, Colorado, in western Colorado, beautiful part of the world. Note on the left side, you've got some file format choices and some product search filter choices. I'm going to select Lidar Point Cloud Arc Grid 1 meter DEM as my choices. Then I'm going to draw a box after selecting the box or point choice at the top and further refine my study area. Note my availability legend on the left side. Okay, now I can save my choices as a CSV file, which is actually quite handy. I can come back to that later with some metadata for my choices, but I could also at this point return to search and look at the different products that are available for my study area. I can see some metadata here for the footprint, and as I scroll along, note that the footprints are displayed on my map, the outlines of the footprints. And I'm really interested in this one right here that encompasses this ridge, as we'll see in a bit. It'll allow us to do some really fascinating northeast versus southwest slope comparisons. So now that I've got that particular one, I'm going to go ahead and look at the metadata for it. Here's the metadata for this particular data set. Note that it's a LAS file. We're going to zoom to it. We're going to download it. It's downloading to my local device. It's a zip file, so we'll need to unzip it. We'll go to the downloads folder and we'll take a look at that zip file. In my case, it's about 187 megabytes. I'm going to move it to the place where I actually want it to be stored and used. It's going to be part of my ArcGIS Pro project. And then I'm going to use 7-zip in my case. You can use any zipping or unzipping program that you'd like that will work. 7-zip works rather well. I'm going to unzip it to this folder. And now I'm going to get a LAS file, an HTML, an XML, a TXT, and a NED data dictionary, and a couple of other things. And I can look at that text file and get more metadata there. Okay, so we've got it downloaded from the national map. We've got it unzipped. We're ready to go for ArcGIS Pro. Let's take one last look at the HTML version of the metadata. And so we've got three versions, one on the web, a text version, and an HTML. Now I'm going to create an ArcGIS Pro project here. So I'm going to fire up ArcGIS Pro. This will work for 2.0 or later. I'm going to start a blank project here, or a new project. Note the path names. Find out where you want it to go. I'm not going to create a new folder. I've already got a folder there, so I'm good to go creating a folder to store my project. I'm going to put it in my LIDAR data folder. That all looks good, so I'm going to select OK, and I'm going to give it a suitable name now. Book Cliffs is the local terrain that I'm studying, so that part is great. Now I've got my Pro project set up, and I'm going to load my LIDAR data into ArcGIS Pro right now. So let's take a look at the files we've got just as a review. I've got a toolbox, an APRX, which is my ArcGIS Pro project, and a couple of other things. I've got a geodatabase as well that it's set up for me. So I'm going to load my data into that geodatabase, my LAS file. There's my geodatabase that was set up when I created the ArcGIS Pro project. I'm going to go to Analysis, Tools, and I'm going to search on Create LAS dataset. Now sometimes you're able to bring in LAS files directly into ArcGIS Pro into a map. Sometimes not. It depends on how the LAS files are set up. In this case, I actually need to create a last data set before I bring it into the map. So I'm going to navigate to my last file. I'm going to go ahead and open that. And I'm going to output it into a last D, which is a last data set. Note the coordinate system and projection of your LiDAR data. It is, in my case, in UTM zone 12 north. But you want to pay careful attention always to the projection information. And so if it's not projected, you'll need to define projection. In my case, it is projected, and that's great. So I'm going to go ahead and run that. It's creating a last data set and successful creation of that. Perfect. So I've got my last data set inside ArcGIS Pro from the National Map LiDAR data set. UTM coordinate system. Super. All's well so far. We are doing great. You can check the geoprocessing environment if you'd like. That way you can semi-automate the connection and folder information. I'm going to go ahead and insert a new map now, as you see here, so I can actually see my data. I can go ahead in the catalog pane on the right side and expand that, and I see my last data set right there, as well as a couple of other things, including the metadata. There's my file extensions. But my last data set is one I want to drag over to the map. So I've got a topographic map base, which is showing up right now. If I zoom in just a little bit, I see my point cloud for my LiDAR data. Ah, looks nice. Now I can do things with it, right? I can create a slope map, an aspect map, all kinds of things. This is my ground photograph of the area of interest. This is my study area showing the ridge that you are examining right here that's running from the northwest to the southeast part of the map. Okay, now let's go ahead and visualize the LiDAR data that you've brought in from the national map. If you go to the Appearance tab, Symbology, you've got some choices there. Let's go ahead and select Elevation. And we'll just take the default for starters. 9 class, natural breaks, Jenks, University of Kansas, rock chalk. So that's what that area looks like. Okay, ranging from blue, low elevation, to reddish, high elevation. And now I'm going to go ahead and create a slope, visualize it as a slope map. And so I can click around here and get the elevation and the slope and the aspect, the direction that the slope faces, in degrees. All right, so far so good. Easy to bring in this data into Pro, for sure. Now let's go ahead and create an aspect map, the bluish, meaning that it's facing southwest, and the reddish facing toward the northeast with that sharp ridge in there. As you see, and that's with a default 10 class aspect map inside ArcGIS Pro. Let's go ahead and create some contours. Visualize this in contours now. Now I can click around and see the elevation, slope, and aspect once again. And I'm taking the default at the moment, drawing the contours with a contour interval of 5. It's important to note the elevation units, of course, this being in meters. So know your data, examine your metadata to see what your units are. So we've made a slope. We visualized it as slope, aspect, and contours. Now let's create rasters from the LiDAR data. We've just visualized it so far. We haven't really created any data set indicating slope or aspect or anything else. So let's go ahead and do that. So last data set to raster is our tool that I searched on, as you saw. And my input is the last data set. My output is going to be bookcliffs_raster. And my value field I'm going to make as elevation, taking a look at some of the choices there. I'm good with all of those things. I'm going to go ahead and select run at the bottom. So now I'm running that last data set to raster command. It's a tool. It's a geoprocessing tool inside ArcGIS Pro. Once done, now I've got a raster data set for my last file. I can go ahead and go to last filters now and select ground. I can also go to last filters and select first return. What does this mean? This means I'm going to get what the ground surface is, and also the first return. In my case, the first return is really going to be from the vegetation. So I'm going to get a vegetation surface, if you will. And now what I'm going to do is convert last data set to raster, and I'm going to make the output Book Cliffs ground. So now that I've filtered it to ground, I'm going to convert last data set to raster and run that, taking the defaults here. Now I've got a ground surface. Should be bare earth. Now if I select first return, and now with the geoprocessing tool last data set to raster, I'm going to call that output first return. Now I'm going to have a raster of the first return. In my case, it's the tops of the vegetation, pinyons and junipers in this case, especially on the northeast facing slopes. In your case, it might be buildings, it could be something else that's giving you the first return. But now my objective here is to compare the first return from the ground. So I can look at the values in there, in each one, the first return and the ground. Super. Now let's use the raster calculator to get the difference between the first return and the ground. So here's the first return and the ground showing up in my choices. I'm going to take the first return minus the ground, both of them being rasters. My output raster is going to be named Book Cliffs because that's the area of interest for me. That's my study area, the Book Cliffs. And I'm going to call that vegetation height because that's really what it is in my case. The first return is the tops of vegetation and the ground is the ground surface without the vegetation. So subtracting the two is going to give me basically the vegetation height. Should be basically zero on the southwest facing Mancos shale slopes. They have no vegetation as you saw in that photograph that I took on the ground. And I'm going to change the colors so that I can visualize this perhaps a bit better. Now I'm going to change the symbology to classified, natural breaks. Is that giving me anything better? In some ways it does, because now I can see that I do have a higher vegetation height for the northeast facing slopes, which was my objective to show. The northeast facing slopes and the northeast part of this image is the pinyons and junipers. The southwest facing slopes are truly just the Manco shale, so there's no vegetation whatsoever on those slopes. And that gives me exactly what I was hoping to see. That's good. I'm going to go ahead and change the base map to a satellite image so I can see the satellite image of that area. Now you can see the pinyons and junipers on the northeast side of the study area and the bare earth Manco shale on the southwest side of the image. Excellent. And of course I could make this semi-transparent and look at the data with the satellite image below it as well. Take a look at some of the metadata here. All right, now let's make a hillshade out of our ground raster. We're going to take the defaults for the azimuth, which is from the northwest, the altitude 45 degrees above the horizon, and we'll call that hill SH for hillshade. We're going to run at the bottom there. And there's our hillshade. Zoom out a bit. Now we've got a very nice looking hillshade there, visualizing the surface.